What would it mean for the platform? And when he's asked whether he's a free speech absolutist, and he says yes, I guess what does that mean? And one of the big questions I have as a member of the media is, would he let someone like Donald Trump back on the platform?
Welcome to this week's Wacky Moments of Leftist Extremism. Yet another memorable week in the media land of the left. A week where MSNBC held a panel on the differences between Republicans and Democrats.
Republicans, in some ways, understand what really motivates their base. It's that they make this argument about culture wars. They want to lean in on transgender rights. They want to talk about crime. They want to talk about critical race theory. They want to get people feeling like America is slipping through their fingers. And Democrats, in some ways, are trying to focus on the nuts and bolts. They're trying to focus on inflation.
Well, I do agree that Democratic leadership is focused on inflation. I mean, they know how to really keep it rising. In fact, this week, the Bureau of Labor Statistics reported at 8:30 a.m. on Tuesday that inflation increased by 8.5% over the past year. That's the largest 12-month increase since December of 1981. So you know those morning news shows, they knew it was coming, they were waiting for the numbers to be released, they had reporters ready. Let's see the breaking coverage from Good Morning America.
Detours and twists, but together we are here.
These morning messages, now inspiration for my new book, Brighter by the Day. To share my lessons learned on how to embrace the joy mindset.
Happiness is a pursuit. Joy is a choice. And when it comes to shifting our mindset, that's where it all starts.
Wait, well, there it is. It was in the crawl. Well, they were almost up against a break, surely. I mean, GMA must have got to Biden's record inflation in the next segment.
Such a happy morning here at GMA. Now we have Jonathan Van Ness here, JVN. We got to know him as the hair guru on Queer Eye, but you know he's also quite the writer. He's already a New York Times best-selling author, and now he has a new book out. It's called Love That Story, Observations from a Gorgeously Queer Life, featuring essays about everything and anything from his personal style to body positivity. Good morning to you.
Hi.
We've had such fun already.
Yes.
No coverage for the record inflation. I mean, why talk about that when you can have a man in a dress? All the network morning shows largely ignored the breaking inflation news on Tuesday, but by the evening, most in the leftist media had figured out what the Democratic talking points were and started to parrot them. Inflation is all Putin's fault, and there is so much good economic news being obscured by this little inflation thing. Bring on the panel.
Mark, President Biden is blaming Putin for good reason. But will midterm voters buy that?
It's tough, Stephanie. I mean, just ask Jimmy Carter about his second term presidency. The problem is that, I mean, first of all, when you're explaining, you're losing in politics. The second problem is that this is just throwing a huge wet blanket over a lot of other news, and a lot of it's good.
What? You didn't know about the good economic news? Well, here it comes.
And there's news when you parse through all this. And part of the news is that when you take energy and food off the table, and obvious, and granted, that's a lot of the equation, but when you take those off the table, prices actually decline 0.4%.
Sure, that 0.4% drop doesn't include energy, food, hotels, appliances, furniture, but shoot, you know, things are really good. Cat trees seem to be on sale this week. Also, real worker earnings fell by another 1% during the month, so that's the good news, I guess. I'm not going to say that the media only spouts a Democratic viewpoint, but I will let them say it. Bring on Andrea Mitchell and her Thursday panel as they sit in befuddlement as they ponder GOP measures like saving babies.
Let me just also point out, moments ago, Florida's Governor Ron DeSantis signed a ban on abortions after 15 weeks. Yesterday in Kentucky, Republicans overrode Governor Beshear's veto of a sweeping abortion bill. And earlier this week, Oklahoma's Republican governor made abortion a felony.
He seems so lost. Next, they pondered an Alabama law that says things like, you can't castrate a minor.
Making a gender-affirming care a felony. And nationally, more than 300 bills targeting the LGBTQ community have been introduced this year alone. So why this relentless focus on an already marginalized group?
What it appears to be happening here is creating a boogeyman, boogeywoman, boogey person.
Ah, the boogey person. Well, of course. But what's even scarier to the leftist media than the boogey person is the Second Amendment.
Georgia Governor Kemp signing a bill Tuesday allowing residents to carry handguns without a license. This amid rising gun violence nationally. How is that playing likely to change key states like Georgia?
Well, again, the Republicans think the gun issue works for them.
That darn gun issue in this Constitution? I mean, can you believe these people?
This happened on a subway, and my immediate thought today when I saw this was obviously concern for the people there, and was that there is a Supreme Court case right now, a challenge that would basically essentially strike down New York gun laws and essentially find that the Constitution gives a right for everyone to carry a gun in any state.
Because it does, actually. It looks like Chris Hayes is just realizing that, and he's about to crap his pants. Call Panera Bread and ask them to stop supporting that little doughboy. It's not only thoughts of constitutional freedoms that strike fear into the heart of leftist media types. Freedom on the internet does as well. MSNBC launched into a series of reports on the maybe, possibly, these things could happen if Elon Musk buys Twitter.
Will you soon have to pay to use Twitter if Elon Musk gets his way? Maybe. He's trying to buy the platform, and here is what he said about it just moments ago at the TED conference in Vancouver.
Twitter has become kind of the de facto town square, so it's really important that people have both the reality and the perception that they are able to speak freely within the bounds of the law.
Oh my goodness, free speech! That thought is just so terrifying to MSNBC.
Because there are real and devastating consequences for using that platform.
Oh, free speech has its consequences, and it may result in outcomes they don't like when these platforms don't censor stories that hurt leftists, like, say, Hunter Biden's laptop during an election year. You know, I just wonder what Katie Turr's real concern is.
And if the shareholders were to take him up on the offer, what would it mean for the platform? Mm-hmm. And when he's asked whether he's a free speech absolutist, and he says yes, I guess what does that mean? And one of the big questions I have as a member of the media is, would he let someone like Donald Trump back on the platform?
Oh, the truth comes out. As a member of the media, she's concerned she might have to hear from a man that she doesn't like. Imagine that.
Would he let someone like Donald Trump back on the platform?
Well, it's time to wrap things up. I'm Eric Shiner from MRCTV, asking you to visit the MRC store where you can purchase some great conservative gear and also help a nonprofit. Be sure to check out the new look at MRCTV.org, where you'll find the latest in news, entertainment, and videos. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe to these videos on the platforms where you see them. And we'll be back next week with more leftist media madness.